Welcome to Global VID, a podcast about original productions and international TV and film distribution. I'm your host, Eric Y. Lapointe, and we're about to learn how people in our industry are expanding their footprint and finding the right partners around the world. This show was created by NL Global and is also available as an audio format on Apple, Spotify, or your favorite podcast application. Well, today is pretty special as we have now hit a milestone with our 20th episode. Thanks to everyone out there for listening. And if you enjoy the show, please hit that subscribe button, leave a comment, and share with others so that we can continue to learn from each other and the experts within the TV and film industry. This is our first Futurist episode. While normally I focus on what people can do now, in this episode, we are taking a step back and focusing on the long-term view of what our industry should expect. So skip this at your own risk, because today I have the independent creative strategist Sandra Lehner, who talks to us about Generation Z, branded entertainment, NFTs, and the metaverse. Let's dive right in. I am very excited today to have you on the show, Sandra. How are you?
I'm great. How are you, Eric?
I'm very good. So I think this conversation today will be interesting because we're going to dive into some things that are not quite familiar to me, like Gen Z, NFTs, metaverse, and that whole world. And we'll also talk about branded entertainment. But first, please introduce yourself to my audience.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Eric. So I'm a creative strategy director. I'm based in sunny California and I create strategies for brands. Could be a personal brand, could be a TV brand, a commercial brand, so they can reach their goals and their audience with entertaining content.
So why don't we dive right into your background? Because part of the show, what we do is we take a look at how people got into the industry. And obviously, you just moved to LA. So one of the stories I want to hear about is, why in the world did you move to LA during a pandemic?
I've been wanting to move to LA for quite a while. I don't even remember how it started, but I think I just grew up with the OC and 90210. And I always had this dream living in California, you know, going surfing in the morning, which I'm not doing right now, but you know, there's still this dream. I mean, I was very lucky that I always worked for very innovative companies or innovative departments. So my first job was in drama development at UFA Serial Drama in Germany, but we were mostly doing web series, and that was 2006. We produced web series. And then I moved to the UK and I was lucky enough to work on incredible projects, like an app for Sherlock, an app for Downton Abbey, a fan show for Made in Chelsea. We created a Twitter game for Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. And even in Switzerland, the social TV channel I worked for, like this was the first social TV channel where all shows were interactive with social media integrated in Europe. But then unfortunately they went bankrupt and I started working for advertising agencies. I think that was the point when I realized if I want to do something really innovative, I need to get out of Europe and I need to go to America and particularly California, because I think in Europe, people are very risk averse. Like it's really hard to get something off the ground, not conventional, and where, you know, you can't prove the return of investment, where it's more like investing in the future, you know, in something innovative, in grabbing the attention of the next generation, for example. And then the pandemic hit and I couldn't move here. So this summer felt like the first time in a year and a half where I thought I can risk it now. I can go on this adventure.
So let's move on to our first topic, which is Generation Z or Generation Z if we're in Canada. Please tell me about this audience, because one of the things that you had mentioned to me, and this was kind of a shock to me to some extent, that television is not even at the top of their preferred method of entertainment consumption.
Yeah, exactly. Their fifth favorite pastime.
I think what was surprising for me on that one was that for millennials, television was still number one. That's maybe the disconnect for me. How did we go from millennials who still consider television entertainment number one to the next generation that flipped it upside down?
Yeah, so we're referring here to a study that came out recently by Deloitte. It's their media trends survey that they do on a yearly basis. So I'm just going to say the favorite pastime of Gen Z is video games. And when you look at the preferences of millennials, video games is very, very close to watching TV and movies. So it's not like it's going down, you know, from millennials. It's millennials and Gen Z are already mostly interested in video games. I just want to add that the survey was conducted during the pandemic. And during the pandemic, people used video games to stay connected to each other. So for example, Amazon, they created watch parties so people could watch shows on Amazon Prime together. And, you know, Facebook has watch parties as well. And it was just a big aspect to stay connected to your friends and family. And I think this is why the preference for video games is so much higher than it was before.
So what do producers have to do now to keep these people, this generation, engaged?
I believe there are three strategies that you could use as a producer. And the first one is go to the platform where this audience is, Gen Z. So you would go to a video game platform like Twitch, for example, or, you know, work with a video game like Fortnite or Roblox. Fortnite is actually, they're moving into the entertainment space. So they're talking about creating movies for Fortnite. So it is already going into this area. And then the second strategy is you work with an influencer, a Gen Z influencer, which is Netflix doing. They just produced a film, He's All That, with Addison Rae, who's a big TikTok star. And they inked a multiple film deal with her to bring in this audience. And my cousin's daughter, she's 10 years old and she's a big Addison Rae fan. And she wouldn't watch Netflix in particular, but of course, you know, as soon as the Addison Rae film was out, she watched it. And the third strategy would be that you use IP this generation is already familiar with. And this is what Wattpad is doing. So Wattpad is a writing app, a fan novel writing app for Gen Z. And for example, The Kissing Booth on Netflix or After, they're based on Wattpad stories. Wattpad just bought Webtoons as well. So, you know, we're going to see a lot of comic adaptation, I guess, in the future on Netflix. And also Netflix is moving into the video game space as well.
Interesting. You know, because there's been past episodes where we've talked about Netflix in particular and how they, up until now, they've only had one business model, which is going to make it harder for them to retain their customers in the long run, because every other platform these days has other motives to build their businesses. Amazon might not care whether or not you are watching the content. What they care about is that you're in their ecosystem and you're a member so that you can also order content. Apple, on the other hand, they are also in the content space and creating premium content, but they also care about selling devices. And yet Netflix has been kind of a one business model company for the longest time. And now we're hearing little inklings of them coming out with new business models like the video game.
I'm a little bit obsessed with Netflix because I see it exactly the same way you see it. You know, subscribers are limited, so they need to come up with different commercial models in the future. So I'm keeping a close eye on what they're doing. So first of all, they announced a partnership with Walmart. So they're going to sell merchandising for their show at Walmart here in America. They open a store in Japan, a retail store. And then they also announced a branded content show with Starbucks. They're going to talk about movies, which makes sense because a lot of the Netflix movies are based on books and it's in the setting of a Starbucks cafe. So they're moving into branded content, they're moving into merchandising, they're moving into video games. Also, they're creating a lot of verticals at the moment. So they're creating fan communities around anime, around movies. They're actually hosting a film festival in France in December about comedy. And so they create these verticals to engage their fans even more and target, you know, content to this very engaged audience. In my opinion, this is the way how to win this streaming war. You need to have very committed, very engaged fans, you know, that come to your platform.
Let's just take a step back and talk about Fortnite again, because I'm not really familiar with that. It's a video game, right?
Yeah.
How can producers somehow promote on Fortnite and on a very basic level?
Yeah, Fortnite is moving into the entertainment space at the moment. During the pandemic, they hosted a lot of concerts. And they also hosted a watch party for Christopher Nolan's biggest films.
Okay.
And then the trailer for Stranger Things.
If there's a concert on Fortnite, are we watching a real live concert with real live action people on stage? Or are we watching an avatar of a musician?
We're watching an avatar, which I find very interesting because there's a show on Fox called Alter Ego. It's a talent show, singing talent show, and they only have avatars as well. And I read an article in the Rolling Stone magazine with Will.i.am, who's a judge on the show, and he was actually saying that the winner could go on and do a concert, you know, on Fortnite or Roblox, for example. I have another example. It has nothing to do with TV and film, but I still think it's an amazing example how to use Fortnite. So it's a campaign that Wendy's did, you know, the fast food chain, because Fortnite had this food fight mode and it was Team Pizza against Team Burger. And Wendy's found out that the burgers from the burger restaurant in the game, that they used frozen beef. And for Wendy's, that's a no-go. They would never use frozen beef. So they participated in the game, destroying all the fridges, you know, where the frozen beef was in. This is, you know, a campaign where the brand authentically comes into the video game space. I was very excited about this one.
Well, I guess I'm going to have to get myself a Fortnite game to understand what all of this is all about. Do you recommend that for me, or it's too late for me, Sandra?
I think it's always good to understand like the basics of a platform.
Yeah, I agree. You know, and you're maybe going to be angry about this when I say this, but I still haven't tested out TikTok.
Ugh.
And I should, I know I'm in the industry and I should, but it's one of those platforms where I've kept it at bay. And believe me, I was trying everything just 3-4 years ago.
Yeah, I must say, TikTok is very addictive. I try to stay away as well, because then, you know, an hour is gone. But what I like about TikTok is I've never seen a more creative space. It's just unbelievable. And especially the young Gen Zs, what kind of videos they create. It's just so full of innovation, inspiration, and creativity. So you should really check it out.
For some reason, I have it in my head that TikTok is not too different than Snapchat. And even, in fact, I think just Like a few weeks ago, Snapchat announced that they're going to start incorporating music into their platform to compete against TikTok. How different are the two platforms?
Yeah, Snapchat is an interesting company because I remember years ago, they had this design change and they lost so many users and everyone said Snapchat is dead. But I think they're the most innovative company in the social media space. They come up with new features and then everyone copies it. Snapchat is focusing more on augmented reality, which I find really interesting. So they're trying things like putting yourself in a Snapchat show, you know, how to get you play a part in a scripted Snapchat show. In that sense, that this platform is really interesting for TV producers.
So, but we're going to get off topic if we keep talking about TikTok and Snapchat, because that was not on our agenda, but I'm glad we talked about it nonetheless, because it does cover what a younger generation is currently doing instead of focusing on TV. And I think what I get from this is that from this conversation is that producers are going to have to do a little bit of a deeper dive and experiment themselves with new platforms like TikTok, like Snapchat, but also maybe buy a Fortnite video game and test out what that looks like and see what their competition is doing in that space, especially if they're throwing concerts and watch parties. And you mentioned earlier, finding brands that generation connects to so that you can create IP around that to really bring them back into the ecosystem. Do you think this younger generation will always be juggling multiple devices, multiple platforms, that no matter what, we're going to see kind of the vision of what we were talking about 10, 15 years ago, which was the second screen environment?
Yeah, exactly. So I'm a millennial. I'm the second screen generation. So I was excited, you know, 10 years ago, developing play-along apps for TV shows. But now this generation is the five screen generation, and they just go seamlessly from one platform to the next. And we're going to talk about the metaverse in a little bit. And I think this is why for this generation, this is really exciting, because they're on so many platforms. And, you know, it's going to be key to move your avatar or your digital goods from one platform to the other. What you need to realize is the consumption habits are very different. I just saw this Dutch web series, actually it's called Heat, and they released it on a linear schedule, but you could also go online on the website of the public broadcaster and explore every episode in your own time and in your own way, because the episodes were structured by a character, so they told the story from different point of views. And you could either watch it in a linear form, you know, on TV, or you could go online and explore it the way you want to do it. And I think this is key, that you need to learn how they consume content and also how the platforms work. You know, when we talk about social media, this is key. But I think everything starts with knowing your audience. There was this very successful Gen Z show recently called Scam from Norway. So the Scandinavians are very big on Gen Z series. For everyone interested, I recommend have a look at, you know, what Finland is doing, what Norway is doing. And so the creator and producer of Scam, Julie Andem, she interviewed Gen Z for like a year. So she was asking them about their problems, you know, about their consumer habits, what they're scared of, what their hopes for the future. And then she created Scam, and it was sold to multiple countries. It was sold to Germany, to France, Italy, even the US on Facebook Watch was Scam Austin. You could watch the episode at the end of the week on NRK, or you could follow the characters on social media and experience the story in real time, basically.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So I've developed a framework recently to bring all these different aspects together, and I call it the ABCD framework. So A stands for audience, B for brand, C for creativity, and D for distribution. You need to know your audience and then integrate your brand in a meaningful, authentic way. For example, what Wendy's did, you know, with Fortnite, it was very authentic. And then it comes down to creativity, because there's so much content out there, and to break through the noise, you need to create something very compelling. And then know your distribution platforms, because they all have algorithms. You need to understand what content works, you know, and when you should release it.
Well, this is actually a perfect transition into our next topic, which is the crystal ball of the future. And we are going to be talking about branded entertainment, as you just brought up, and also metaverse and also NFTs. But let's continue talking about branded entertainment. Now we're seeing brands integrate themselves very seamlessly into stories. What can we expect in the next few years from the branded entertainment space?
We will see a lot more branded entertainment in general. There are so many streaming services, and as we discussed earlier, you know, subscribers are limited. So you need to find new commercial models to finance your shows. Mm-hmm. And I believe partnering with a brand should be on every producer's mind. And I'm super excited about branded entertainment, because it's a co-production, you know, and it's really interesting to bring it all together, to bring the brand's goals together with the producer's goals, with the broadcaster's goals. Maybe there's an agency involved. And I think this is why a lot of TV people are worried that the quality will go down, you know, if they involve a brand. But in my experience, they brand marketers, they usually listen to you, because it's not their expertise. You know, they're not TV producers. They don't know how to produce a TV show or how to make a movie. So they usually rely on your expertise. I mean, what they usually want is product placement. So they want to show their product, or they want you to mention their product. But if you explain to them that the audience doesn't want that, because then it comes across as advertising, and this is not what branded entertainment is. And I think it's just key to make them understand, you know, that again, it's all about the audience, and you need to focus on them. And if they like it, they will remember your brand, and you don't have to show it in, you know, every scene.
And I think that's part of what I saw 5-10 years ago, where there wasn't much difference between, like, in the early days of branded entertainment, they were talking about this, but I think the brands were still struggling knowing how they would integrate themselves beyond product placement, beyond the obvious of like, oh, let's show our logo in a really obvious way. Like, no, like, take a step back, integrate yourself within the story.
Yeah, and I think it can go both ways. You know, I think as a TV producer, you can approach a brand. If you think this brand would be perfect to be integrated in your show, I think you should try talk to them. But also brands, you know, who want to be more in the entertainment space, they should go out and talk to TV producers. If they like a show, I would approach the production company and ask them if they want to work with them. And I think it should go both ways in branded entertainment. And I think we will see this in the future, because I think they're all realizing that, yeah, they need to explore new commercial models in the future.
And now let's talk about the metaverse space. First of all, what does that even mean? Like, a lot of us are learning about it now, especially right now, because Facebook just announced that they are going to be changing their name to Meta, because they want to go more into the metaverse space. So please explain to me, what does metaverse mean? Like, what is the 101 on that, so that all of us can feel smarter because of you, Sandra?
So the metaverse, it's usually referred to as a future iteration of the internet. So it's a 3D persistent shared space where you can seamlessly move your avatar or your digital good. So for example, you buy on Snapchat, you buy some Gucci sneakers, but you can only wear them, you know, in the Snapchat. But with the metaverse, you would be able to wear them in Fortnite and to wear them in Facebook. So it means that you can move your avatar from different platforms to the next. So experts say that we're still a decade away from it, because there, you know, you can already see there are a lot of IP issues and technology issues that might come up with this, but we're definitely moving into this direction. And yeah, as you mentioned, Facebook changed their name. The Facebook company changed their name to Meta. And Mark Zuckerberg said at an internal conference that they're going to focus on the metaverse rather than on social media from now on. And I think that's what he has to do, because when you look at Facebook, you know, the users are just getting older and older, and Gen Z is not interested in Facebook. And then, you know, Instagram was having a lot of bad press recently. WhatsApp, he can't really use for commercial reasons. So I think focusing on the metaverse and bringing all these platforms together, that's a smart move.
If we wanted to experiment with the metaverse space, are there early things that we can do right now to kind of get our feet wet? Is there a company or two that you would recommend that we should research?
Yeah, I mean, the closest are Fortnite and Roblox at the moment.
So right now it's through gamification that people are entering into the metaverse space, but the likes of Facebook might have other plans in how they go from in that metaverse space.
You know, Facebook's model is to keep you on the platform, right? I mean, this is why they have the algorithm. They try to show you things you're interested in. This is what the algorithm is about. So they try to keep you on the platform as long as possible. And if Meta plays a big part in creating the metaverse, that's lucrative for them.
Right, right. Okay, so that's something to follow very closely in the next little while, because it sounds like this is not a trend. This is something that's going to revolutionize the internet as we know it. And if I think of my parents and how they struggle with Zoom, let alone anything else, I'm going to have to get with it and start to test a little bit more with Fortnite and a little bit more with TikTok, as we mentioned earlier in the show. Okay, let's move on from metaverse and talk about NFTs, because this is another hot topic these days that everybody's talking about. And I want you to explain to our audience on a very basic level, what is an NFT and how can it be used in media?
Okay, NFT stands for non-fungible token, and it's a block-based token that proves ownership of a digital imagery. So it uses the same technology that cryptocurrency uses to prove the authenticity of a digital asset. And so what we're seeing right now is big studios that own a lot of IP, they're creating NFTs as collectibles.
Okay.
So you own a JPEG, or you could, or even TikToks, you know, they're trying to sell TikTok videos as NFTs as well.
So with NFTs kind of being kind of an easy thing to understand if you're a celebrity and you already have a following, I think that makes it harder for other creators and other producers to get into the game if they don't have the same kind of reach. But as a user, for us to kind of experiment with what's coming down the pipeline, if I had $100 to spare to experiment with NFTs, where should I spend it? Where should I test it?
Yeah, so there are marketplaces for NFTs, for example, Super Rare and OpenSea, and you can try it out there. But at the moment, it's usually young digital creators putting their work up on these platforms, and they create a following very quickly.
Yeah.
So I think as a independent producer, it's going to be hard at the moment. The way I see it is you're either an up-and-coming digital artist or you're a big brand that owns IP. You know, even CNN is selling their most memorable moments as NFTs. So if you have this community already, then it makes sense for you. Or if you're just starting out and you're super creative young dude, you know, who is like knows the in and out of cryptocurrency as well, then NFTs are the right thing for you. So yeah, with NFTs, I think, yeah, you need to create a community. You need to be part of the community. I think this is key. You need to be interested in what's going on in this community, because you know it's what I said earlier with brands integrating themselves in an authentic and meaningful way. If you just want to make money, no one is going to buy from you. Like, they need to feel that you're part of the community, that you understand them, and you know you want to be one of them. If you just want to sell to them, it's not going to work.
I think those are brilliant words, where you're really saying that producers nowadays have to focus on building an audience. So what I'm hearing from you is that this is going to accelerate even more and faster. And the job number one of producers is going to be, or anybody in the entertainment space, is build an audience that will follow you wherever you are going.
Exactly.
I was just going to say that, you know, in some ways that's what Mark is doing, Mark Zuckerberg. Mm-hmm. He has an audience of God knows how many people.
Billion, yeah.
Billions. And he is taking them to another place. He's going to guide and hold our hand into the metaverse space, which could be scary. We'll see.
Even if you're in the pitching process, it becomes so much more important now that you already have a fan community. If you can show a broadcaster or a streaming service that you have, you know, that many thousand people already interested in your topic, then you're more likely to get a commission than if you don't have anything to show. So I think for a TV producer, it's key, even when you're starting to create a show, to create a following.
Yeah.
And then, like you said, yeah, I mean, you know, Netflix, Amazon, they have amazing social media teams.
And it's already there. We are already talking about the shows that are getting commissioned these days by the big platforms like Netflix and Apple. It's all about the star status. So it's people who are already coming with their audience. You know, like think of Kevin Hart or The Rock. You know, like we've talked about them in previous episodes just recently. When they come to the pitching table, they come into the pitching table with an audience. And so producers can come to the table with a great idea, but now they're going to have to start building their own audience and building their own marketing capabilities at the same time. This has been a great conversation, Sandra. Thank you so much for sharing all this insight on the world of metaverse and NFTs and Generation Z or Z. I keep wanting to say Z, but then I have to say Z for our American audience. So if people want to reach out to you, what's the easiest way to reach Sandra Lehner?
Well, I'm on all social media platforms. I just launched my website, sandralehner.com, where you can find me. Or just LinkedIn is a great place for this too. And like I said in the beginning, I think even your personal brand is important these days. You know, think about your personal brand. Think about your TV brand.
Thank you so much again for your time today and teaching us about the future and the Generation Z and where things are headed.
Thanks for having me, Eric.
All right, take care. Bye.
Bye.
And that concludes today's episode of Global VID. Thanks to my guests Sandra Lehner, our editor Nicole Almeida, and the theme song composers Amber Goodwin and Aaron Ross. See you next time.